ريكوردينج ولا
سوي فول سكرين.
لحظة ريس تطلع الباوربوينت شير سكرين شلون؟
بس دوس فول سكرين.
ريكوردينج. Okay, good evening everyone. Today I will try to present a talk about the radiological evaluation of endocrine bone diseases. And I hope you'll get benefit from it. The talk is a little bit long because there are many endocrine bone diseases, as you can, as I'm sure you all know. So in case we didn't, we are not able to finish today, we will continue tomorrow at the same time. And all of you are welcome to join. Okay, so first of all, what's the definition of endocrine bone diseases? These are the diseases of the bones that are related to hyper or hypofunction of the endocrine glands. So what I mean is that any endocrine abnormality, any hormonal imbalance that results in bony changes, these can be considered as endocrine bone diseases. So if there is any hormone that is increased in amount of production or decreased amount of production, in both cases, these can be defined as endocrine bone diseases. First of all, one of the most common and the most well-known bone diseases, endocrine bone diseases, is the hyperparathyroidism. So hyperparathyroidism, it's by definition, it means increase in the parathyroid hormone production, which can lead to the parathyroid hormone. Its function is to resorb the calcium from the bone. So the radiological manifestations will be primarily in form of increased bone resorption, and at the same time, increasing bone formation. So there is resorption and formation excess at the same time. The plain radiographic findings, the conventional X-ray findings, there will be findings of bone resorption and bone sclerosis at multiple sites because it's a systemic disease, it's a generalized illness. And the hyperparathyroidism are classified into primary, secondary, or tertiary hyperparathyroidism. It can be primary, secondary, or tertiary. And we'll know the difference between them in a minute. Okay, everything is okay. Good. So we'll know the difference between them in the following slides. First of all, the primary hyperparathyroidism is it represents the vast majority of the hyperparathyroidism cases, which are up to 80% of them have a single adenoma in the parathyroid gland. There is an adenoma in one of the parathyroid glands, which are all we know. There are four parathyroid glands located posterior to the thyroid gland. Most of the time, sometimes they might be ectopic in position, but one of them, if it's have an adenoma that is hyperfunctioning, this will result in increased or excess parathyroid hormone production. Multiple parathyroid adenomas can occur, but it's only in about 4% of the cases. Another type of parathyroid excess parathyroid hormone secretion is due to chief cell hyperplasia of the glands. Is due to chief cell hyperplasia of the all glands occurring in about 20% of the patients, and carcinoma of the parathyroid gland is very rare, accounting for 0.5% of the cases. While the secondary hyperparathyroidism, occurs, it's secondary to other conditions. So any condition that result in low serum calcium, any condition that causes hypocalcemia, low serum calcium, will lead to secondary hyperparathyroidism. There will be hyperparathyroidism secondary to low serum calcium. For example, vitamin D deficiency, intestinal malabsorption of calcium, chronic renal failure, which is mostly the most common cause of secondary hyperparathyroidism due to the lack of the active metabolite of vitamin D, which is 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol, also in cases where there is retention of phosphorus. So the most common cause of secondary hyperparathyroidism is chronic renal failure. Regarding the tertiary hyperparathyroidism, it is there will be an adenoma that is autonomous, and it may develop in a hyperplastic parathyroid gland. So if there is a secondary hyperparathyroidism for a long time, for sufficiently long time, there will be an adenoma of the parathyroid gland that is autonomous. It works independent from the rest of the body. It excretes parathyroid hormone regardless of the need for this hormone in the body. So as a result, there will be, usually it's associated with a chronic renal failure, it can be observed also in patients with long-standing vitamin D deficiency and other causes of osteomalacia. So most of the cases of tertiary hyperparathyroidism are suffering from secondary hyperparathyroidism due to renal failure for a long, long, long time. Now, what is the clinical presentation of hyperparathyroidism? What do these patients complain of? How do we see them? What's the history of the hyperparathyroidism? In cases of primary hyperparathyroidism, most of them, they have no symptoms. They are asymptomatic, just hypercalcemia by lab test, but there is no complaint or symptoms. Clinically, in younger age groups especially, features of hyperparathyroidism are features of hypercalcemia. It's the same as the features of hypercalcemia. There are renal stones, nephrocalcinosis, high blood pressure, acute erythropathy, resembling gout, so it's a pseudo-gout kind of thing, due to deposition of calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate, which causes chondrocalcinosis. Also, patients will complain of finding secondary to bone resorption, like osteoporosis. Other features of hypercalcemia include peptic ulcer, acute pancreatitis, and depression, confusional state, proximal muscle weakness, non-specific symptoms like lethargy, arthralgia, difficulties with mental concentration. All of these are features of hypercalcemia, okay? The hypercalcemia is due to the hyperparathyroidism, due to excess parathyroid gland, parathyroid hormone excretion. What about the radiologic findings? What do we, as a radiologist, what do we need to look for or to detect on the X-rays or radiological, different radiological modalities? First of all, there will be subperiosteal erosions, intracortical bone resorption, chondrocalcinosis, brown tumor, also known as osteitis fibrosa cystica, osteosclerosis, osteoporosis, and metastatic calcifications. So now we'll talk about these seven features one by one. First of all is the subperiosteal erosions. The most sensitive site that we need to look for this subperiosteal erosion is the radial aspect of the middle phalanges of the index and middle finger. So you look for the index, you look for the middle finger, you look at the radial aspect, okay, of these phalanges, and you look for subperiosteal bone resorption. And you'll see many examples in the following slides. Other sites that we need to look for, including the distal phalanges, we look for acroosteolysis, that is lysis of the distal part of the distal phalanges. Also on the outer end of the clavicle, symphysis pubis, sacroiliac joint, proximal medial cortex of the tibia, and the proximal humeral shaft, ribs, and femur. If found in sites other than the phalanges, this indicates more severe and long-standing hyperparathyroidism. So it starts in the phalanges. If you see the abnormalities elsewhere, then this indicates a severe and long-standing condition. Also may be found in secondary to chronic renal impairment. Now, if we look to this X-ray of the hand, you can appreciate there is a diffuse osteopenia. The bones are diffusely osteopenic, and you can see there is subperiosteal resorption here. You can see this thin line, that is the periosteum, and you can appreciate the subperiosteal bone resorption. The bone is not formed well in the subperiosteal, okay? And you can see at the distal phalanges, they are light, they are lytic, they are resorbed, they are not very well formed. You can see the distal phalanges are almost missing. This is what we call acroosteolysis. Okay, now this magnified view can show you the acroosteolysis. You can see the bones, the distal phalanges of the fingers are eroded, okay? And you can appreciate the osteopenia, and you can appreciate the subperiosteal bone resorption. And if you look carefully, you can see there are some tunnels, like some small lucent lines within the bone cortex. These are cortical tunneling, which are also features of hyperparathyroidism. An X-ray of the rest, you can appreciate there are diffuse osteopenia. You can appreciate there is a resorption of the ulnar and radial styloid processes here. Also, subperiosteal resorption can be appreciated here. So these are all features of hyperparathyroidism. Now, this is another example. You can see this is a patient with long-term hemodialysis. There is a subperiosteal bone resorption in addition to extensive vascular calcification. You can see here the digital arteries are calcified everywhere and it's bilateral, almost symmetrical. This indicates vascular calcification is due to the secondary hyperparathyroidism, which is secondary to the renal failure. Here we can see, this is X-ray of the foot, of course, and you can see the paraarticular erosions and the resorption, and you can see the organized periosteal reaction around the shafts of the bone. This is secondary to periosteal bony resorption. Another example here, this is a chest X-ray. We can see there is the left side deviation of the trachea, which might be due to large parathyroid adenoma or more commonly due to thyroid abnormality. And you can see there is resorption of the distal end of the clavicle. And there is some erosion at the side of the coracoclavicular ligaments bilaterally. If we see an image, a magnified view of this, you can see here, appreciate there is erosion of the clavicle. You can see here, this is the normal part of the clavicle, and here is the eroded part of the clavicle. And also you can see some ligamentous calcification of the coracoclavicular ligament. This is an axial CT scan, bone window, and you can very easily appreciate the iliac side of the sacroiliac joints are resorbed. The sacral aspect is relatively not affected or relatively preserved. Mostly the iliac side is resorbed and eroded bilaterally, and you can see a lytic lesion here and another lytic lesion here affecting the first sacral foramen. In cases of, if we don't have a proper clinical history and if we don't suspect hyperparathyroidism, someone might suggest these are lytic metastatic lesions. But if you look carefully to the resorbed iliac aspect of the sacroiliac joint, and if you have proper clinical history and have a lab test of the patient, you can appreciate that these are changes secondary to hyperparathyroidism. Now, let's look here. This is a radiograph of the femur in patients with a primary hyperparathyroidism. You can see the scalloped inner margin of the cortex of the femur, and this indicates endosteal resorption. So from the endosteum, there is a resorption of the cortex from the inner aspect of the bone shaft. Now, let's talk about intracortical bone resorption. Intracortical bone resorption is due to increased osteoclastic activity. That means increased bone removal, of the bone by the osteoclasts in the Haversian canals will result in linear translucencies within the cortex, which is called cortical tunneling. This cortical tunneling indicates a prominent or wide Haversian canals. These features are not specific for hyperparathyroidism, can be seen also in other conditions which bone turnover is increased. For example, normal childhood, there is of course bone turnover, and in Paget disease of the bone, which is defined as increased bone turnover. So let's see this example of cortical tunneling. I showed you this image just a minute ago, and you can see very clearly that the tunnels of the bone of the phalanges are prominent, and it's like some worm has buried into the bone, and this is due to excess or extra osteoclastic activity resulting in bone resorption of the Haversian canals of the bone. Okay, and these are not specific to hyperparathyroidism, but in presence of other conditions can be very suggestive. Also, the same finding can be seen in the skull. If you see here, this is what's called the salt and pepper appearance. Salt and pepper appearance all over the skull. The bones are mixed, both lytic and sclerotic kind of thing, salt and pepper appearance. Okay, after treatment of this patient, this was the result, and you can obviously differentiate the difference between the two. Okay, regarding the third finding, which is chondrocalcinosis. Chondrocalcinosis is due to the CPPD deposition disease, or the calcium pyrophosphate deposition disease, which is, it's called pseudo-gout. It resembles gout, but when they aspirate the joint, it will result in CPPD crystals rather than urate crystals. And this CPPD, or the calcium pyrophosphate dihydrate deposition, causes the articular cartilage to be calcified and become visible on radiographs and called chondrocalcinosis. Okay. Okay. Most likely to be identified on radiographs of the hand, in the triangular ligament or triangular fibrocartilage, the knees, in the articular cartilage, and the menisci and the symphysis pubis. Also, other joints like the shoulder and the hip can be seen. I don't know what's this annotation or something someone drew. So, disabled annotations. I'm not very good with this Zoom thing. Chondrocalcinosis, it's a feature of the primary hyperparathyroidism, more in favor of primary rather than secondary hyperparathyroidism. I think we need to remove something clear. Okay, good. So, in this case of primary hyperparathyroidism, you can obviously appreciate that there is calcification within the meniscus of the knee joint. There is chondrocalcinosis here, and the lateral meniscus is also very prominent, and there is calcification of the symphysis pubis. And this, the presence of chondrocalcification is more in favor of primary hyperparathyroidism rather than secondary or tertiary. Also, another example of chondrocalcinosis can be seen here. In this knee joint, you can see calcification within the meniscus of the knee, also you can see here some calcification. So regarding the brown tumor are also known as osteitis fibrosa cystica. These are cystic lesions within the bone. Okay, there is within the bone a lesion, a cyst, in which there have been excessive osteoclastic resorptions, focal part within the bone with excessive, a lot of osteoclastic resorption causing a cystic defect, and it's seen more in primary than in secondary hyperparathyroidism, slightly more, 3% versus 2%. So overall, it is a rare finding. It's rare to see brown tumor in hyperparathyroidism, but if you see it, it is very suggestive of hyperparathyroidism, especially the primary hyperparathyroidism. These cystic lesions are histologically are cavities filled with fibrous tissue and osteoclasts. So the term tumor is wrong. It is a misnomer. They are not tumor, they are just cavities with fibrous tissues and osteoclasts. Okay. With time, there will be hemorrhage and necrosis and liquefaction, and this will result to these lesions to be brown on autopsy or surgically. When they open the bone and see this lesion, it will be in the form of a brown mass, but it is not a tumor, it's just fibrous tissue and osteoclasts with secondary necrosis and hemorrhage. Radiographically, just a lytic lesion, slow density, multiloculated cysts that can occur at any skeletal site and may cause expansion of the of the bone. But now they are very, very rarely to be seen because usually it occurs in long-standing hyperparathyroidism. And nowadays, most of the patients undergo parathyroid hormone evaluation like as part of their routine workup. For example, in this case, we can see here, this case, you can see multiple lytic lesions in the metaphyses, in the metacarpals and in the phalanges. You can see here and here there are lytic lesions, and if you look carefully, you can see evidence of subperiosteal cortical tunneling. If we have, like, for example, another magnified view, these are not metastatic lesions, these are not primary bone tumors, these are brown tumor or osteitis fibrosa cystica secondary to hyperparathyroidism. And if you look carefully, you can see that trabecular pattern, it is accentuated. The bones are more trabecular than usual or than normal. Another case of a hand x-ray with a brown tumor includes here, you can see there's a lytic lesion here, and you can easily appreciate the bone resorption of the phalanges here and here, and the accentuated cortical tunneling and some subperiosteal bone resorption, all findings indicating hyperparathyroidism. Another example of the lower tibia, here we can see as a some sort of a lytic bone lesion, like a bone cyst, for example, but they are not bone cysts, they are brown tumor in patients with non-hyperparathyroidism, and you can see the resorption and the osteoporosis of the adjacent fibula also, okay, and the medial malleolus. So this indicates brown tumor secondary to hyperparathyroidism. In the knee, we can see the same thing. You can see here at the medial aspect of the upper tibial metaphysis, you can see a lytic lesion here and also another one here and another one here. There are multiple lytic lesions which are brown tumors secondary to hyperparathyroidism. Also, they can be seen, as we said, anywhere in the bones, including the skull. You can obviously appreciate the diffuse salt and pepper appearance all over the skull, the salt and pepper appearance with a focal lytic lesion at the skull, the calvaria. This is a brown tumor. Also another example of the knee in the upper tibia, you can see this lytic lesion, which is a brown tumor. And after treatment with vitamin D, this brown tumor almost completely healed. You can see here it's much, much more better and it's resolved, healed, forming a relatively normal trabecular bone. Again, here in the pelvis, we can see multiple lytic lesions. These are the brown tumors, like in the superior ramus of the right pubic bone, in the femoral head. Here you can see another one, and there are multiple lesions. All of them are secondary to hyperparathyroidism, but keep in mind you should have this, the proper clinical settings, the proper lab tests. Otherwise, someone might suggest these are lytic bony lesions, and there will be a huge misdiagnosis. Okay, regarding the fifth radiologic pattern, which is osteosclerosis, it's uncommonly seen in primary hyperparathyroidism. It's mostly in secondary hyperparathyroidism, which is secondary to chronic renal impairment. In the primary disease with normal renal function, if there is a normal renal function with the primary parahyperthyroidism, there will be exaggerated osteoblastic response following bone resorption, while in the secondary causes, there is excessive accumulation of poorly mineralized osteoid, which appear more dense than normal bones. So the poorly mineralized osteoid tissue, it is more dense than the normal bone, and this will accumulate more in cases of secondary hyperparathyroidism, and this will result in increased bone density, especially at the axial skeleton, in the vertebral bodies and end plates. They are preferentially involved, and this end plate osteosclerosis, it is called Rigger-Jersey spine. This is a typical features of Rigger-Jersey spine. We'll see many examples of that in the coming slides. You can see here there is increased sclerosis at the end plates of the vertebrae, here and here and here, and this is Rigger-Jersey spine secondary to renal osteodystrophy or renal impairment causing secondary hyperparathyroidism. Again here, you can obviously see this white lines at the vertebral end plates, here and here and here. So this is called Rigger-Jersey spine, and it indicates secondary hyperparathyroidism, secondary to renal failure. Now, regarding the resorption of bone in general, it will result in osteoporosis, which is due to the extra bone resorption secondary to increased parathyroid hormone. So the parathyroid hormone increase, bone resorption increase, resulting in diffuse osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is more common in postmenopausal females and in the elderly patients in general, because the bone resorption to start with is more than bone formation. So with extra bone resorption, there will be excessive excessive osteoporosis, and this can be confirmed by DEXA dual X-ray absorptiometry, and the DEXA scan is essential for evaluation of osteoporosis in patients with hyperparathyroidism. If we do a parathyroidectomy, surgical parathyroidectomy in primary hyperparathyroidism, when there is a focal parathyroid adenoma and it is removed surgically, it can be reversible and the bone density will increase. The seventh finding that we need to talk about is the metastatic calcifications. Metastatic calcification, it is their soft tissue calcification, it's not metastasis, not tumor. It's just diffuse soft tissue calcification other than the cartilage and the fibrocartilage, and they do not occur in primary hyperparathyroidism unless there is associated renal impairment. So if there is associated renal impairment causing phosphate retention, this will result in metastatic soft tissue calcifications. But if primary hyperparathyroidism alone, there will be no such findings. So, if there are features of hyperparathyroidism, like subperiosteal resorption and extensive vascular calcification, soft tissue calcification with around the joints and the tendons, this implies renal function is impaired with hyperparathyroidism. So the patients have both renal impairment and hyperparathyroidism. okay, if you see this metastatic soft tissue calcifications. For example, this child, you can see this is a 6-year-old with a chronic renal failure, and there is bombing of the ulnar and radial, distal radial and ulnar shafts, and you can see the trabecular pattern is coarse. There is coarsening of the trabecular pattern, and the bone aging is retarded. This is not a 6-year-old. This is much less common. You can see also in the metacarpals due to the excessive bone formation, bone resorption, sorry. This we'll see in the coming slides other features of soft tissue metastatic calcification. Regarding the opposite of hyperparathyroidism, that is hypoparathyroidism. Hypoparathyroidism, it is reduced or absent parathyroid hormone. This can be due to the end organ resistance, like the kidneys, bone, or both kidney and bone, they are not responsive to the parathyroid hormone. So the parathyroid hormone can be present and can be present in excess, but the end organs are resistant. So other causes of hypoparathyroidism, it happens in cases where the parathyroid gland, they fail develop. They fail to form embryologically. And also if the glands are being damaged or being surgically removed. So the function of the gland can be reduced by, for example, any altered regulation or the action of parathyroid hormone is impaired. So in hyperparathyroidism, we said the features are of hypercalcemia, while in hypoparathyroidism, the features are of hypocalcemia. So hyperparathyroidism, hypercalcemia. Hypoparathyroidism, hypocalcemia. Clinically, it causes neuromuscular symptoms and signs such as tetany and fits. Acquired hypoparathyroidism can occur most commonly after surgical removal of the parathyroid gland, secondary to thyroidectomy. Sometimes the parathyroid glands are removed with the thyroid gland. Also from autoimmune disorders can happen. And most commonly, it's seen in 13% of patients with thyroid or parathyroid surgery. There is something called idiopathic hypoparathyroidism, which present during childhood, more common in girls, and it is rare in black races. It's just idiopathic hypoparathyroidism. It may be associated with pernicious anemia, Addison disease, there might be antibodies to a number of other endocrine glands as a part of being having generalized autoimmune disorder. There will be localized or generalized osteosclerosis. More commonly, it's localized, affecting the skull, where the skull vault will be thick because there is low bone resorption, excess bone formation. At an early stage of the onset, the dentition will be hypoplastic. The teeth are hypoplastic if it occurs at the early stage. Metastatic calcification here may be present in the basal ganglia of the brain, also in the subcutaneous tissues, particularly around the hips and the shoulders. We will see some examples of that. A rare but a recognized complication is enthesopathy, which means disease of the tendon. The tendon of the muscles are abnormal. Also, there will be extraskeletal ossification in the paraspinal distribution and elsewhere in the body, so like metastatic calcification. In the spine, the skeletal hyperostosis, it will resemble very closely to that described as senile hyperostosis, or it can resemble other pathologies like ankylosing spondylitis or diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis, like DISH, can have the same or similar features. Extraskeletal manifestations can be seen around the hip, the pelvis, the interosseous membranes, also the tendinous insertions of almost all every muscle in the body. So here we can see very clearly that there are basal ganglia calcification as part of soft tissue calcification, and this is as secondary to hypoparathyroidism. In this CT scan, we can also see the basal ganglia calcification and some calcific foci within the brain parenchyma themselves. secondary to hypoparathyroidism, sorry. Spondyloarthropathy is usually associated with long-standing hypoparathyroidism. Spondyloarthropathy means disease of the spine, okay? It's often clinically occult, but patients may have radiological spondyloarthropathy in as high as 30% to 40% of cases. Radiologically, there will be abnormalities of the spine that will include extensive bridging, osteophytes, bridging osteophytes like in DISH, for example, also ossification of the spinal ligaments, especially the anterior and posterior longitudinal ligaments. Supraspinous ligaments can be seen as calcified structure. Also, as we said, resembles ankylosing spondylitis and DISH, diffuse idiopathic skeletal hyperostosis. Extraspinal abnormalities can involve the pelvis, the appendicular skeleton. In the pelvis, there will be ossification of sacrospinous, sacrotuberous, and iliolumbar ligaments, and ossification at the lateral margin of the acetabulum. Also, the tendons, there will be enthesiopathy, will appear at the lesser and greater trochanter and the iliac crest along the ischial tuberosities. The appendicular skeleton, the upper and lower limbs, there will be again changes at the various sites of tendon insertion, also at the interosseous membrane between the tibia and the fibula, between the radius and ulna. And this has a fluorosis as another differential diagnosis. For example, in this pelvis X-ray, first of all, this is an idiopathic hypoparathyroidism. You can see internal fixation secondary to fracture, and you can see the mineralization of iliolumbar ligaments here and here, and broad ossification of the lateral margin of the acetabulum, you can see here and here. Also, some enthesophytosis at the ischial tuberosities, and capsular calcification at the hip joint. You can see the capsule here is calcified here and here, secondary to calcium deposition. Here, if you have no clinical findings, you might suggest this is possible ankylosing spondylitis. You can see calcification in the lateral aspect of the ligaments and in the interspinous ligament, and this is idiopathic hypoparathyroidism. This might look like a bamboo spine. In this cervical X-ray, you can see the anterior longitudinal ligament is calcified, and some irregular bony, let's say, extensions through the intervertebral discs due to excessive calcium deposition. And you can see increased bone density, diffusely increased bone density, and inferior margin of the spinous process is also appears some ill-defined calcification due to the calcification of interspinous ligament. Also, we said in the interosseous membranes, like here, for example, all of them are due to idiopathic hypoparathyroidism. Again, we can see here idiopathic hypoparathyroidism with calcification of the iliolumbar ligament, but the SI joint is normal. So this will differentiate it from the ankylosing spondylitis. You can see in the same patient, the SI joint is not resorbed. It's relatively normal. So this differentiates this from ankylosing spondylitis. I think we'll stop here and we'll talk about pseudo-hypoparathyroidism tomorrow at the same time. Very glad to hear from